welcome to Military Motor Pool. I'm Tom Townsend, and this is my associate and fellow collector of green machines, Alan Bonney.
This is a show about military vehicles, collecting them, restoring them, and keeping them running.
From motorcycles to tanks with everything in between. If it's big and green and noisy, and in the eyes of some a little bit ugly, then you'll probably find it here.
The history of the military vehicle is the history of warfare in the 20th century. These machines have been the unsung workhorses of battlefields, supply routes, and aid stations and field hospitals of every conflict from World War I through Iraq.
Because when we preserve these, we're not only preserving our history, but we're honoring the men and the women of all nations who had the courage to ride these into harm's way. If there is one vehicle which most completely personifies this vast hobby of military vehicle preservation, then it must be the World War II Jeep. It was used and loved by every Allied nation. It was respected, envied, and copied by our enemies. And now, 60 years later, it's still recognizable almost any place in the world.
The Jeep is not the invention of any one single person. Instead, it evolved from vehicles manufactured from the 1920s and 30s.
Ever since World War I, the United States Army had been looking for a motorized vehicle that could replace the horse. And they tried everything from stripped-down Model T Fords to modified farm tractors.
By 1940, fears of war accelerated the Army's interest in just such a vehicle. Two companies, American Bantam and Willis Overland, submitted their prototypes for testing. The two designs were similar, and although the Bantam vehicle was chosen, the Army was afraid that a small company like Bantam could not produce the huge numbers of vehicles which would be needed if and when we went to war.
So Willis Overland got the contract. But then along came Ford Motor Company, the inventor of the assembly line and, at that time, the largest automobile manufacturer in the United States. So the Army decided that maybe it would be better if two companies built the new Jeeps. And Bantam, the small company that won the design contest in the first place, well, they ended up building trailers.
So now you've found one of these little gems hidden away in some old forgotten barn. How do we know if it's a Ford or a Willis or even if it's a World War II Jeep?
Ford wanted to be darn sure that everybody knew he built Jeeps. So the Ford F-script logo was stamped onto every possible part.
Another small difference between the way Willis and Ford manufactured parts for the Jeep is in the leaf springs. Willis used a wraparound strap like so with a tab bent over. Ford, on the other hand, used a U-shaped clip, which was held in place with a bolt through the top. Both models had two small storage boxes located over the rear fender wells. Willis used a plain flat lid.
Ford added pressed-in ridges to the GPW for extra strength, and he used a rectangular depression around the locks instead of the round one used by Willis. Now you'll find a lot of other changes under the fenders and on the frame, and the Ford F-script logo will even be stamped on some internal engine parts, as well as on the head of every original bolt. While Willis' bolt heads have a less artistic EC,
but keep in mind, these vehicles are at least 60 years old and a lot of parts have been changed on them over the years. Once they entered service and things got fast and furious in World War II, motor sergeants and mechanics didn't care all that much about who built the part they put on a Jeep as long as they could get it out of their motor pool and back into service. In fact, sometimes it's hard to tell if you're actually looking at a World War II Jeep at all.
Usually the easiest way to tell a post-war Jeep from one built during World War II is by the grille and the headlights. Now going all the way back to 1941, the earliest production model Willys was called the Slat Grille or the Slat Grille MB. And like the Willys and the Bantam prototypes which came before it, its grille was made out of welded iron. Now only about 25,000 Slat Grilles were built, as opposed to 335,000 MBs and almost 228,000 Ford GPWs. And all of the Slat Grilles were built between November of 1941 and March of 1942.
At that point in time, both Ford and Willis adopted the new, stamped, easier-to-produce 9-slot grille. This grille was used on all Jeeps from that point to the end of the war.
When the war ended, only Willys produced a civilian model Jeep. In 1946, they came out with the CJ2A. The most notable differences are a 7-slot grille and the enlarged headlights, which are now mounted outside the grille instead of being on hinged ramps behind the grille. And of course, civilian parking lights replaced the World War II blackout lenses.
The headroom for the drivers of the older World War II Jeep was rather limited, so when they came out with the CJ2A, they raised the windshield frame up by about 2 inches.
The fuel filler, which in World War II had been under the seat, was moved to the outside, and the axe and shovel racks on most models completely disappeared. Willis advertised this new Jeep as being the farmer's friend, able to pull a plow in the field and push snow, and then carry the whole family to town and come home loaded down with dairy feed and groceries. So a tailgate was added, and the spare tire mount was moved to the side. Now a heavier duty transmission and axles were added, but the long dependable four-cylinder flathead Go Devil engine went on virtually unchanged for the next few years.
Thanks to many years of research, we're now able to figure out almost exactly when the Jeep was made. That is, if you can still find the serial number.
Willys put their serial number on a zinc-coated steel tag riveted to the frame just behind the bumper gusset.
Whereas Ford stamped their number right on top of the frame near the motor mount on the left side.
Once you've found the serial number and read it, it can be compared to dates on a table like this one to determine exactly when your Jeep was built. This slat grill, for example, we know came off the line on the 6th of March of 1942, which incidentally was the very last day of slat grill production. And we can even surmise that it probably came off the line about noon of that day.
You would think with all the information available today that we'd be able to retrace the history of any Jeep, but that's really not the case. Even the hood number is not related to the serial number. That is, if you can even read the hood number after careful removal of years of paint.
Here are just a few of the Jeep parts suppliers we've worked with over the years. And for more information, go to our website at www.militarymotorpool.tv. But stick around, we're not through yet. Next up, we're going to take a look at a pocket-sized armored vehicle, which fits both the garages and the budgets of a whole lot of military vehicle collectors who would really like to own a tank.
Somewhere deep down inside anyone who loves military vehicles, there's a deep lurking desire to own a tank.
Yeah, but for the vast majority of collectors in the real world, that just isn't gonna happen. Maybe it's because a tank is just too big to fit in your garage.
And the Civic Club isn't about to let you park one in front of your house.
Or maybe your wife has already promised you a nasty divorce no matter where you park it.
Even for many collectors who own Jeeps and light trucks, a 3 gallon to the mile main battle tank isn't very practical unless you've won the lottery.
There are alternatives, such as this British Ferret. It fits into most garages, weighs only 4.5 tons.
It runs on rubber tires, it's street legal in most states, and gets 10 miles to the gallon of regular gas.
But it still has many of the neat things the tanks have, like a fully enclosed turret packing either a 30 cal or a 7.62 millimeter machine gun, a seriously armored hull, and there's a Rolls-Royce engine in the power pack bay.
In addition to all that, as armored vehicles go, it's, well, kind of cute. The first Ferrets entered service with the British Army in 1951. They had evolved mostly from the Dingo Scout Car of World War II, but also from several other vehicles, including the German SD KFZ 222. All had been fast, dependable, and highly successful recon vehicles.
Several models were built, including a turretless Mark I and a later missile-firing Mark V, but by far the most common among collectors is the Mark II-3 that you see here. The history of the Ferret is a history of the Cold War. From the early 1950s through Desert Storm, Ferrets were the eyes and ears of the British armored divisions. Loaded down with radio equipment and totally dependent upon their speed to get themselves out of serious trouble, it was their job to get out in front and sneak and peek at the enemy.
The Ferret also proved to be an excellent vehicle for police and internal security missions. Considerable numbers of them were used by the British in Northern Ireland, while others saw action in Vietnam.
Ferrets have also served in Central America, Rhodesia, South Africa, Angola. They probably fought on both sides in Desert Storm, and they remain in service today with a couple of dozen countries around the world. Although the Ferret went on to prove itself to be a highly reliable vehicle in the service of many other countries, it is a little bit different than anything made in America. Its standard equipment, for example, not only included a gas-fired cooking stove, but also a 24-volt teapot, capable of producing an excellent cup of tea, even while under fire.
It's steered with a wheel, but the wheel is canted forward to make room for the driver's legs, so it takes a little getting used to.
The transmission is a Daimler Preselect, which actually dates back to the English double-deck buses of the 1930s, and it's kind of a gray area between manual and automatic. The driver first selects the next gear he intends to use with his right hand, and then whenever he's actually ready to make the shift, he pushes in and releases a shift pedal with his left foot. The result, if it's done right, is a very fast shift which loses few RPMs.
We mentioned the Ferret's main defense was its speed. Well, it can hit between 50 and 60 miles an hour in either forward or reverse because it uses its transfer case to change direction. At the moment the vehicle comes to a stop, the driver pushes in the shift pedal, moves the transfer case into reverse, and releases the pedal. The Ferret can then accelerate through the same five gears in reverse, just as it did in forward.
Unless, of course, the driver misses his shift and gets the transfer case into neutral. Then the only way to get back in gear again is to shut off the engine, engage the transfer case, and restart the engine.
Not exactly one of the Ferret's strong points. Another trick the Ferret has to help it beat a hasty retreat are six smoke grenade launchers mounted on the bow and aimed to fire as a screen.
Ferret gunnery is primitive. The turret is hand-operated, using a handle for the left hand, which doubles as a brake, and the machine gun mount pistol grip for the right. But with a little practice, the turret can be traversed and the gun aimed very quickly.
Even faster when you're being shot at, the machine gun is aimed either with the open sights on top of the turret or through the gunner's periscope, which contains a nifty little holographic circle which appears when the gun is on target.
Only about 4,400 Ferrets were built, so today they're a fairly rare vehicle, at least when compared to over 639,000 World War II Jeeps or nearly 563,000 GMC 2.5-ton trucks of the same period. And quite a few Ferrets have been imported to the U.S. by collectors. There are usually one or two for sale in the trade publications, and one comes up on eBay every few weeks.
How about parts?
There are several suppliers of parts in the U.S., and even more in the U.K., where the stocks are still good. They tend to be expensive, but still fairly easy to come by. Unfortunately, most Ferrets came into this country in good mechanical shape, so restorations usually require fewer replacement parts than, say, a World War II Jeep that spent its last 30 years on a hunting lease.
Tom, you've had this Ferret for a long time, and you've done a lot of things with her.
Yeah, Bluebird here is one of my favorite toys. We've owned her for about 10 years, and besides doing military vehicle shows and parades, we've done Vietnam reenactments and worked on several film and video projects together.
Oh, that's right. I believe we have a clip on that. No Oscar, right?
No Oscar. But believe me, it's a really uncomfortable feeling watching that rocket come at you, even when you know it's made out of cardboard and running on a wire. But anyway, for those of you interested in exploring the possibility of owning a Ferret, here's a list of some of the importers and parts suppliers that we've had the pleasure of working with.
Up next, we're on our way to the Wings Over Houston Air Show, where we're going to meet with other military vehicle collectors who have their machines on display at one of the largest air shows in the Southwest. See you there.
Coming to Wings Over Houston is like old home week for me. First time I did this show was almost 20 years ago. And come to think of it, I drove here in the same 42 GPW that I drove here in today. I think we were both running a little better back then. Wings Over Houston is sponsored by the Commemorative Air Force. Now, if that name doesn't ring any bells, it's probably because they used to be known as the Confederate Air Force. But no matter what name they're going by, their mission and their passion for many years has been restoring and flying vintage military aircraft. So it didn't exactly take a Hollywood director to figure out that if you're going to show off the warbirds of World War II, Then you need the military vehicles of World War II right out there with them.
This vehicle originated in a rusted hulk condition. It was parts and pieces and rust, and was put together from the parts in what we call a ground-up restoration. It's a 1944 WC-56 Dodge Command Car. It's the kind of vehicle that'd be used by high-ranking officers, Army officers during World War II. The engine in this vehicle came from Denmark. It's a Studebaker engine, came brand new in a crate with 0 miles on it. Right now it's got about 1,600 miles on it. My son Michael has been involved in both this project and another project I have, which is a 45 Willys Jeep. What's wonderful about Michael's involvement is, aside from learning about the vehicle itself, he's learned a lot about history. Not just World War II, but it's ignited an interest that he has in history of all eras. And we drive these things together, we go to parades, we go to these air shows when we can, and we've met a lot of good people, a lot of interesting people, veterans who come up to these vehicles and they start telling their stories. You learn history from them, you learn about them, you learn about your own vehicle. I even met a Frenchman one day who was standing outside in front of my Jeep, and he was crying. The last time he'd seen a U.S. Army Jeep was at the time that Paris was liberated. You meet people like this, you see situations like this, and it makes this hobby, makes this passion, if you will, worthwhile.
Well, this is a 1941 Dodge Command Car. It was actually found still being used on a ranch in Langtree, Texas. And we picked it up. It's an earlier version of the 3/4 ton. This is actually a half ton vehicle that they used early in the war and actually prior to the war. This one was made in January of 1941. It has a much higher profile, and like I say, it's a half ton compared to 3/4 ton that you use later in the war. It has smaller tires, and it actually will run faster on the highways. This particular model was, a lot of it is still the civilian power wagon of pre-war. And when they completely redesigned it, they made it 3/4 ton. We took it down to the bare frame and did a lot of body work, sandblasting, rebuild the engine, and put everything back together with a lot of new parts, a lot of new rubber parts in it. A lot of the engine parts were replaced. And of course, new paint job, new cable for the winch, new headlights, new lights, new wiring harness, a completely brand new wiring harness in it, and brand new top, new tires.
And this was kind of a father and son project too, right?
Yes, it was. Father Chuck, we did it together. He's actually the one that found it, and then we brought it back and we restored it together.
Basically, this is a 1944 World War II inmate armored car. It was used for reconnaissance back in World War II. Patton generally had two of these in a recon division, be two M8s and four Jeeps and machine guns. Basically, the mission for this type of vehicle was, because it has six wheels, would go ahead of the U.S. Army to locate the enemy. Back in World War II, the radios only reached about 50 miles. So what General Patton would do, he would send a recon team out about 100 miles, locate the Germans. They would come back and report the Germans and their locations, which is why General Patton was able to get ahead of most armies in World War II. The M8, this one has personal history, did arrive in the Normandy invasion, did survive it, got in toward the latter part of World War II. Most of his mission was used for MP control for the German prisoners. The M8 was also used in the Korean War and the latter part of the Vietnam. This M8 particular one was used in the United States Marine Corps until 1962. At that time, a gentleman up in Dallas purchased the vehicle, used it on his ranch, and then left it in deplorable condition. Approximately 9 years ago, through a broker, I was able to locate it. I picked it up, I restored it, put it into the condition that you see right now. It took approximately 2 years to restore the vehicle to what you see, what it is right now. It is in mint condition, it is 90% restored, everything is working, it has hydraulic brakes, hydraulic steering system, the vehicle is all original. There are none remanufactured parts in this vehicle.
Now, the real crowd-pleasing highlight of this show is the reenactment of the Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor in 1941. That's a show you just can't stage without reenactors and without military vehicles. So while the fighters and the dive bombers are mixing it up there, we're going to be down here right in the middle of it. December 7th, 1941, about 7:30 in the morning at Pearl Harbor, time of the Japanese attack. All right, this is the middle of the attack. Those bombs going off out there are 50-gallon drums filled with gasoline and high explosive. They're lots of fun. You feel the blast from them a quarter mile away. Hey, what can I say? War is fun. When it only lasts 10 minutes, everybody's shooting blanks, nobody gets killed, nobody even gets hurt, and as soon as it's over, we all go have a beer with the enemy. Have we hit on something here? Nah, never works. Well, that's all for now, folks. I'm Tom Townsend.
I'm Alan Bonney. Go find them, fix them up,
and keep them rolling.